scoring-wise is similar to last year. You've got five guys in double figures. I'm imagining still some improvement can come with ball movement. And a big right. part of that is so many new guys, I'm sure.
Right. And that's, you know, when we talk about growth offensively, I still think we're taking some bad shots, some tough shots. And so we're seeing that on film. We're trying to do as much teaching as we can that way, and that we're not wanting to play. It's not so much play slower, it's just be more patient in understanding what's good shot, bad shot. Because we do have guys that I think can shoot the basketball. Some of the percentages are down a little bit because they're taking some contested shots. And we've got to learn what that is. That, yeah, you want to play fast, but you can't be hurried up to where you're taking contested shots. We got to work the offense. I think right now, analytically, we might be faster than what we were last year. And that's not good. Because last year's team had many more vets to it, a lot less young players to it that really understood the college game and could play at that pace efficiently. And I don't think we can play at that kind of pace and still be the efficiency that we want. So that pace has to slow a little bit. It's not like we're wanting to, again, not play slower. It's just to be a little bit more efficient in our offense by playing a little bit more patient and working a little bit harder to get an uncontested shot.
When you say faster, you mean possessions per game?
Yeah, well, possessions per game and the speed at which we're playing. Last year's team averaged having the ball about 14 and a half seconds per shot clock. Of all the power schools, we were number one in efficiency and pace of play last year. And we had the makeup to do that. I'm not sure this team has the makeup to be able to play at a pace where we were averaging 14 seconds per shot clock. I think we've got to go into it a little bit more. Seeing that number go from 14 to 17 would probably be a little bit more pleasing to me, to where we're still playing fast, but we're not hurried up to where we're taking the first contested shot. Let's pass on the contested shot and make two more passes and get an uncontested shot.
Is there an update on Jalen?
He's day-to-day. We're going into practice right after this. I know he's starting to do a little bit more. It's probably going to be a game day decision with him just to see how he goes through the night, he'll do a little bit more today, I'm sure, with our trainer. It's still a mid-ankle sprain, but I have not gotten clearance that he'll play tomorrow, so it's probably going to be a game day decision.
When you see Prince have a big game like that, any thoughts that, man, we could have used him last year? You know, I know obviously he was hurt part of the year, but...
Right. He was. I mean, we just didn't have the opportunity because he didn't get healthy until about the second week in January. So, you know, going to Prince, I'm like, you know, redshirt's always an option. I don't want you to feel like you've got to come back and play 14 games. And he, his family, and myself, after talking, just thought that's too much of the season to not get to do anything, not to redshirt. So it's worked out. He got practice at the end of the year last year, and then he was able to have a really good summer of getting better. I'm very happy for him because he's waited a long time. He had some good minutes and good moments in his freshman year, and then he had the injury, which never is easy to deal with. And now he's really worked hard on his game. So I'm pleased that he's got off to a good start, and he's working hard, and he's seeing some of the benefits to his hard work.
We haven't asked you about Lonzo yet as far as how he's done this with the Lakers. What have been your thoughts? He's obviously been very closely tracked by many people who have scrutinized him both ways, good and bad. What have you thought?
Yeah, I know I saw Steph Curry, he made a comment, you know, please, I hope you not evaluate me after my first 20 games. I go back and look at my first 20 games, you know, I hardly played in my first 20 games. So that's a hard area to evaluate a rookie in 20 games. One, every team's different. You're learning different situation with different teammates, learning to play with different teammates. You have a really shortened preseason in that you're only playing four exhibition games and only 2 weeks of practice, where back in the day you had a month of practice and you played 8 to 10 exhibition games. That's going to take some time, both for Lonzo and for teammates. But, I was actually at the game last night with the Clippers, and the thing that I am very impressed with him is I think defensively, he's really working at it, and defensively he's growing in that area, and that's for a rookie. I think that's the hardest thing coming into the NBA is to learn what you have to do defensively. And I was very impressed with that. But I just think he's got to get the ball. When he's got the ball, he makes people around him better. And I think the more trust there can be in Lonzo being the guy that facilitates the offense, because right now what's being critiqued is his jump shooting. That's not who he is. He's not a shooting guard. He's not an off guard. He'll make shots when he's starting to make you make shots. That's how Lonzo makes shots. Lonzo will make shots when everybody else understands his role is to help you make a shot. That's just how he, that's how he works. That's why he's dialed in as a, he's an unselfish, I want you to look good first, and then my stuff will happen. But, you know, I think that's what hadn't taken place yet, is all that trust of get me the ball. He really is. In my 27 years of coaching, I've never seen anybody at the collegiate level, and I think it will transpond to the professional level as well. Anybody move the ball north-south any faster and more efficiently by the dribble and by the pass than Lonzo. And when that trust happens and he's allowed to do those things, I think you'll see teammates' game go up. You'll see passing, the joy of passing will go up in that organization. And when that happens, he's going to get easier shots, and he'll make those shots.
I know you want to follow up, if I could. Thought about tweaking a shot in Australia. He came back and stuck to his form. Do you think that he should stick with his form, or consider changing it?
I think that's totally up to Lonzo. I know one of the things, we knew he wasn't going to be here long, you know, so we're in agreement it wasn't going to be an issue. But, you know, he shot 41, 42% from the college three. I think all of us that watched him, they weren't college threes. He shot NBA threes last year, you know, at a high level. So, but it's different. When you go from high school to college, college to NBA, it's different. They're bigger, stronger, faster, more athletic. The game gets faster. I think he was as well prepared as possible because of how fast we played and the freedoms that he had with the ball. I think it's just a matter of everybody's trying to learn. Teammates are trying to learn. I'm sure coaches are trying to learn. Lonzo's trying to learn of just what's best, you know, for the team and for Lonzo. I'm not probably as worried about his shooting as a lot of other people are, because I know to trust him, because I know he can make shots. I really truly believe that he would make shots if he was getting other people to make shots. That's his demeanor. If he sees you making shots from his pass and what he's doing to facilitate, then I guarantee, I bet he starts making a lot more shots. And when the onus is on him making shots, it's just not who he is. It's his first notion is, how can I make you better? And I think that's what makes him special.
Coach, do you think he is as cool on the inside as he appears on the outside, despite what he's
doing? Yeah, well, he is, but it's tough. You know, you're an 18, 19-year-old kid, and now you're in the pro business, and as you know, Jim, it's a whole different world. It's not college where, you know, you got all the things in college as far as people, they give you your agenda every day. Our guys know where they're supposed to be, whether it's class, the training room, the weight room. We feed them 24/7 now. You know, now that's, you're getting big money, but now you got to do things on your own. You got to figure things out on your own, and it's a big business. So. But there's a lot of guys in 20 games that in their careers, and I'm one of them, that would love to be doing what Lonzo has done through 20 games to start his pro career. And I just know Lonzo, he is a tough, hard-nosed competitor that has a tremendous IQ. And if there are any issues of struggle, he'll figure it out because he's that talented.
You said you don't think this team is as equipped to play as fast as last year's team. Why do you think that is? Is it just the changeover?
Well, we got five guys that didn't play last year. Last year, we only had three freshmen. This year, we started the season with six freshmen. So, you know, we got a lot more young guys. We had two guys that sat out. Alex Olszynski and Prince sat out last year. Last year's vets of Bryce and Isaac. And Tom was a vet, who's now a senior. Aaron had 2 years under his belt. We just had a lot more vets and a lot less young guys. Now, we got few vets, a lot more young guys. So if you play at the pace that we're playing, which again, I love the pace, but I think with like the last game of Irvine, we had seven turnovers. That's encouragement, that's growth, because we just beat a Wisconsin team with like 16, 17, 18 turnovers, which that didn't happen very often to beat a Wisconsin game team turnover over that many times. So we've got to get those turnovers to where it's 11, 12 consistently. And if we can do that, then the speed will take care of itself. But I still think we're a little bit sped up, we're a little bit of a hurry offensively. And then that affects our defense. There's got to be a good balance. And I thought Irvine was the first game that we really had better balance to our offense and defense. We didn't shoot the ball well. We didn't shoot the free throw well. And we didn't make as many shots as we normally make. But I like the pace, both offensively and defensively, in that game a little bit better than some of the others.
You're at 64% free throw shooting. Where do you want it to be?
75, above 75. We actually, I'm a free throw guy, so I actually say 80, which is probably unheard of. But I think a good number, you definitely have to be in the 70s. But you're a really good free throw shooting team if you're at 75. And we're climbing because we were really bad. Now we're just bad at the foul line. But I've told the guys, and I've told the young guys, it's more that we've worked on some fundamental stuff. We've worked on changing some guys and just making sure there's balance and there's a lot. I'm a big alignment guy. I think how you get aligned on the free throw line is huge. So having your lower body and upper body in line, how you hold the ball, how you put your feet on the floor. Prince, 2 weeks ago had his left foot in front of his right. That can't happen. You're not gonna make free throws. And he's gone from 30% to 58 in two games. So you're seeing improvement there. So just tweaking some of the things with our guys, and then it's on the player, because then, as you know, shooting can become a mental thing. And so now it's a mindset of, and that's what we have to do as a team. We gotta grow with our toughness, and we've gotta be able to make foul shots that we're making in practice. Now those have got to be translated into gameplay where people are in the stands and they're keeping score and there's pressure of that. You've got to have the toughness to be able to go up and make shots. I will say this, the good thing about this team, young in the season, we're getting to the line. Got to the line against Irvine, I think around 40 times. That's huge. If we have a goal of getting there 30 plus with our offense, we'd like to put enough pressure on you to where we're getting there 30 plus now. We're getting there now, we just gotta take advantage of that.
Knowing that so many of the guys are freshmen, does that give you hope that there could be growth as far as making those free throws?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you look at all of them, I think we've got Chris Wilkes in the 56, 57 range. We got Chris Smith in that same range. I think Jalen might be in the upper 60s, if not low 70s. Prince is still in the 50s, who didn't play last year. And there's no reason why all four of those guys aren't above 75. There's no reason at all. So there's opportunity there for tremendous growth. And those are four guys we want to get involved because of how they attack offensively. And that's the mindset. You know, Chris told me I wasn't even trying to get fouled. And I'm like, no, that's not the mindset. The mindset is you got to get fouled. You got to work to where you are wanting to get fouled and get to the free throw line. And so it's all about a learning process, but the free throw line can be a tremendous weapon, both as an individual and even more importantly as a team, of how you go about setting your offense up. Like last year's team, it's hard to compare last year's team because we were such a good shooting team. The ball would move, again, kind of like Warriors at the ultimate level. It's not about them getting the free throw line as much as it is can they get open shots because they can really shoot it. And we were kind of like that at the collegiate level last year. This year's team is, we drive it harder. We got more length. I think we're trying to finish at the rim more than last year's team. So the opportunity to be fouled on this year's team, I think, is much better aligned than what it was last year. Because if there was a negative to our offense last year, we didn't get the free throw line enough. But it's catch 22. We're making a lot of threes instead of getting the free throw line.
Steve, how are the spirits of the three freshmen right now that are suspended?
They've been good, you know, whether it's been myself or the assistants, you know, we're just touching base with them. Really, their focal point has been on academics because they missed a lot of class. Our whole team missed a lot of class. And then they missed it probably another 3 or 4 days. So it's just getting caught up academically. That's been their biggest, most important thing. You know, they're not in team functions, they're not in practice, they're doing things on their own. They're obviously allowed to use facilities and those type of things, but we're just letting them get their feet back on the ground and get caught up academically. As things kind of go through the process, that's the most important thing.
And are they allowed to work with the training staff?
Or? They, when you say training staff, like coaches?
Strength and conditioning, that.
No, obviously if you're in a weight room, you can be overseen because of liability. But there's nothing in structure as far as, from a training standpoint with coaches or anything. They're not doing anything with any coaches. Now with the strength coach, because of liability, if they're in the weight room, then they will get, they'll get overseen that way. If there was an injury, a trainer would be able to take care of them at this time, but I don't think, to my recollection, there's no injuries or anything with the three of them. So all their workouts are on their own.
Yeah, but do you know, are you keeping tabs on how they're, you know, keeping in basketball condition?
No. No, not from a basketball standpoint.
And you know, do you when do you anticipate a final decision?
It's hard. That's really on the school. It's in that process right now, so it's just got to run its due process. And then when that process ends, I'm sure the administration will then bring me in. And whatever they've decided, obviously, then I weigh in, and there'll be a resolution to it.
So it's not, it's, are you, is that a kind of a in concert decision in terms of administration, you weigh in, and then?
I think everybody's involved, but right now it's, you know, it's with the student council and what they're going through, the process they're going through, that you just do within our school, within our system, and then we'll get feedback after that's over.
How much have you been talking to those players, or not much at all?
I don't know what how much is, but,
how often?
You know, that's hard. You know, coaches are just communicating as much as we can through text and calls, and we see them occasionally as they go through, whether it's Pauley or the Austin Center, to do their workouts and just making sure they're fine. Really, most of the communication, to be honest with you, I'd say 98% of the communication, are you in class? Are you doing what you're supposed to do academically? That's really what the communication has been since they've been back.
Is there a feeling that how they are doing academically will help them at all with what's going through in the student council here?
I don't think it's going to have much to do with the student council or change anything into what's happened. I think how it helps them is it keeps them moving forward academically. While you can't move forward athletically like you want right now, it's important that that's the part of being a student athlete, that the athlete part has been taken away right now. The student part has not. So you've got to continue to value that education and take care of this quarter that you're in and do the very best that you can. So that's where it helps them. And they don't have the athletic part as an issue right now. So all your concentration can be on having the best quarter that you could possibly have. And in the long run, that does help you very well.
Do you have time for one more question? The fact that they've acknowledged what happened, there doesn't really need to be an investigation. Do you think that's going to move up the timeline?
Yeah, it's a good question, Ben. Because obviously everything's laid out, and Dan did that extremely well in our press conference of exactly what took place and what happened. And so I don't know to what extent the investigation is. Again, that's a school deal. I don't know all the ins and outs about how that takes place or the length of time. I don't think it's like a, I don't think it's, we're talking about months, but again, I don't control that, so I don't really know the answer to how long that's gonna be. But you're right, most of it's, you know, pretty much taken care of as far as knowing what happened.